fever as a symptom is actually the result of body inflammation, and it's a way of the body for removing pathogens that have gotten in somehow, whether it be from a wound or whether it be from some bad food poisoning or something else that has gotten in, a respiratory disease like influenza. Fever is just a normal way that our body copes with it. So most normal pathogens can be overcome with the body fever. So wound injury and inflammation is essentially localized fever that we see when an injury gets warm. You see redness and swelling associated with it. Normal body temperature is around 98.6 or 38°C. And if we look at the other animals in the animal kingdom, kind of particularly just interested in the ones that people typically, if they eat meat, will eat. It's interesting to note that all their normal body temperatures are several degrees higher than human body temperature. For example, a cow's normal body temperature is about 101, sheep, 102.3, pigs, 102.5, and birds, chickens, 107.1 is their normal body temperature. So it's interesting that if they have a pathogen that gets passed on through their body to someone who consumes it, it may harbor pathogens that we as humans, even with our fevers, can't easily overcome. Plant pathogens are typically not going to have any impact on humans. They have very low body temperatures, plant temperatures, naturally. But because the animals have a higher body temperature to start with, those pathogens that live with them are going to have a higher set point at which they can survive. And a person's normal fever, 100, 101, if it's a normal kind of pathogen, 102, should be able to kind of deal with that. But as a fever rises, and if you have a resistant pathogen, it can make that fever have a prolonged expression. And as we'll see later, it can actually have a cyclical nature where it has a period where it spikes and then a period where it decreases. And it's the worst, as my friend experienced, when it's high at night, when you're trying to rest, and low during the day, relatively low, 101. and there's some different ways to approach a cyclical fever like that. In addition, you want to treat a fever, kind of pay attention to a fever treatment when it gets around 103, 104. You want to be getting it down because it can have brain injury effects as it gets higher. As the heat increases, it can untwist the proteins in our body, and we call that denaturing, and it can cause brain damage. Our brains are a very delicate tissue that are susceptible to heat. The rest of our body can actually withstand quite a bit more heat. Up to 110 or so, with relative ease, they're going to start sweating and doing other kind of cooling activities. but the fever is going to be functioning with it to help to reduce it. So the body can withstand up to 110 or so, but you're going to want to keep that head area nice and cool to keep it from getting hot and having brain effects from a fever. So that's the primary reason for lowering a fever, aside from it being uncomfortable and very hot, is because of the brain, potential brain effects with that. So causes of fevers, infection, other diseases, sometimes tumors can cause fevers to manifest themselves. So some natural ways of reducing fevers. If it's accompanied with nausea, and nausea and fever is probably going to be something like food poisoning. So leftover food residue in the stomach could be the underlying issue. So you may need to purge the stomach. Vomiting or an emetic can aid that process if you can't do it. And if that'll help clear the pathogen out of the stomach and help reduce the fever because the pathogen is expelled. If a person's too ill to clear the stomach by vomiting on their own, they can be given a myrrh and golden seal tea that can aid in that process. And the recipe for that is one heaping teaspoon of golden seal steeped with half a teaspoon of myrrh in a pint of boiling water for 20 minutes. Then you take a cup of that And then following 1 teaspoon per hour as you attempt to get them to clear their system of the pathogen and help lower the fever. So that's if it's like nausea from like leftover food residues and things like that. Another way that fever can be reduced if you have a high fever that is not responding to other things appropriately is you can do a cool water enema. So that's going to be cooling from the inside in the colon area, right where the core temperature is the hottest. And you want to use cool water, but not cold water. So just slightly below body temperature. Obviously, if you have a fever, your core temperature is going to be higher than your normal body temperature at 98.6. So 98.6 or just slightly below that will help to reduce the fever significantly. So you can also use water that is infused with herbs, red clover, or some other types of herbs can also be beneficial for that. Water is a powerful anti-fever and fever-reducing agent. One of the reasons that it's able to do that is because it has a high heat capacity. Essentially, water takes a lot of energy to change at 1 degree Celsius or 1 degree, and that energy is what's called a high heat capacity. So it can suck up a lot of heat and absorb it as it changes temperature. And so in a fever situation, it reduces the fever. So there's basically two different ways that happens. There's heat transfer to the water. And if you use the enema, it also can remove putrid colon substances that are just kind of there rotting in the colon and just clear things out. So that can be helpful. So in order to do that, of course, you need to have an enema bag and some tubing for doing that, a bedpan or an easily accessible toilet. There's some good things you can read about how to do that. But that can be a way if someone has a persistent high fever to get that fever down into a manageable area. Another way that you can address a fever is using a sponge bath. So that's using just a sponge on the body with tepid water, and begin with the face, work down the body, back of the neck, around the head. That helps to cool down the head because the head, again, is housing your brain, and it's the most fragile tissue of your body as far as heat goes. Work down around all the way to the feet, and you can leave the soles of the feet wet so that there is moisture there and you'll have evaporative cooling take place. If you have a really high fever, like 103 plus, you can repeat that procedure from head to toe every 5 minutes, and giving sips of cold water every 5 minutes. Again, that internal sipping is going to be cool from the alimentary canal at the top, whereas the enema was coming from the bottom, so you could kind of hit it from both ends to help reduce the fever. So there's a possibility the patient could chill. If the patient chills, stop, cover them with a blanket, use a hot water bottle or fomentations over their stomach area to help bring their body temperature back up and take the chills away. If the chills persist, you can use a hot fomentation down the spine area or a hot foot bath. So just a container of hot water that they carefully put their feet in. They can put a blanket around them. Just do the traditional hot foot bath and a warm drink. So you can have some back and forth. So this needs to be done with someone who's observant, and the patient needs to kind of be partnering with their provider for that. Also keeping the bowels clear and moving well, a laxative sometimes can be helpful in aiding that process. So another way to address a fever, this is fevers that aren't super high yet, but like a fever that's maybe on the way, basically just use the good old-fashioned lemon, take some water, squeeze that lemon into the water, and drink some lemon water. That can be very helpful. Don't use any artificial sweeteners or cane sugar or anything like that, because that sugar will actually reduce your immune system anyway and compromise it further. So fresh squeezed lemon juice can be helpful in a slight fever, and to kind of help take that away and reduce it. Some herbs and fruit juices. You don't want to use sweetened fruit juices. If you do use any kind of a sweetener, raw honey is the best. So a severe fever, you want to drink often, and that's water, but also various teas can be helpful, and lots of it. one thing that my friend encountered, he had several series of severe night sweats, changing his shirt like three times through the night, woke up the next morning with a severe headache. Well, you need to replace and rehydrate that water that you're sweating out from the evaporative cooling process. So make sure that you're well hydrated as you're doing that. So here's some herbal teas that are known to be beneficial for fevers. Red raspberry leaves. This is noted as being very helpful for children. Gentle in that regard. Willow bark or leaves. Yarrow is known to be able to break a fever within 24 hours. So a yarrow-based tea. Slippery elm. So slippery elm is the inner bark of the elm tree, and it's a very very soothing and helpful herbal tea. If it's like this one here, you'd want to use a tea ball as an infuser to do that. It becomes quite gelatinous, and it's actually very nourishing and soothing to the GI. So that gelatinous mass, you can actually consume and eat, and has nourishing qualities to it. So slippery elm is helpful in that regard. Fever breaks, red sage, catnip, peppermint. Peppermint is helpful. Many people have peppermint tea around the household. You can actually even use peppermint from your garden too. You probably wouldn't want to use this in the evening because it can have a tendency to keep you a little bit awake because it has some stimulating qualities to it. But peppermint is a great soother. So in this regard, I mean, I've used it personally when I'm driving long distances in a tea to kind of help keep me awake and alert as I'm driving. It's not caffeinated, but it does help to kind of keep you perked up a little bit. Wild cherry bark, valerian, black cohosh, tansy, chamomile. So chamomile, around here we have something called pineapple weed, which is a kind of a local native chamomile species, and looks like a daisy with no petals. And that can be dried like I've dried this and crushed and used as wild chamomile. Elder, pleurisy root, marigold, and nettle actually has some fever reducing qualities. Nettle is just an all around good plant to have around. Lots of different good qualities for stinging nettle. This was dried from our pasture. Very useful in that regard, as well as others. And lobelia is supposed to be very good for fevers too. So as you would go to use these, I'd recommend going and investigating how they're specifically used so you know how to best apply them. So a couple other herbs that have some very well-noted characteristics. Shepherd's purse. When I mentioned shepherd's purse, because it's actually, it grows all over the place as a weed. It has little heart-shaped seeds. It's grown all across the U.S. As a weed, and it's excellent in fever and in various kidney complaints, as well as other benefits, but I'm focusing on the fever aspect right now. So for shepherd's purse, you would take a teaspoon, heaping teaspoon, and boil that in boiling water for 30 minutes. So steep it for 30 minutes in boiling water, and then you want to drink it cold, not hot. Again, you don't want to be adding heat to your body when you have a fever. So drink the tea cold, 2 cups maximum per day. Use large mouthfuls at a time. That will help. If it's cold, it's going to help cool down the head area in the buccal cavity and your cheeks, just as that cool fluid is against your cheeks. It also is beneficial for diarrhea. Another one that's a Pacific Northwest plant that's very beneficial is fireweed. Fireweed has a lot of really, really excellent qualities. And one of those is fever remediation. So the whole plant is used again. So blossoms, roots, leaves, stems, they're all beneficial. It's also a good tonic and blood purifier. But you do want to take it only 1 week at a time, either as a tea or a capsule with food. You don't want to take it for more than a week in a stretch. So take a break. After a week's use. If you're using it for a fever, hopefully you don't have a fever for more than a week, so that shouldn't be too much of an issue, but just keep that in mind. a heaping teaspoonful in boiling water for 30 minutes. You want to drink it again cool, 1 to 2 cups a day, and again, wash that around in your mouth to help with the cooling aspect of that coldness. So here's another list of various herbs, and I'm just going to throw this list out. If you hear something that catches your interest, jot it down, because there are a lot of different things here that it's nice to know that there are options to choose from. And in different places across the country, you have different herbs that are right at your doorstep, and even maybe in your kitchen cabinet. So parsley is the first one, thyme, borage, fenugreek, hyssop, red sage, fringe tree, magnolia, sage, vervain, dandelion. So dandelions everywhere. Here's some dandelion and dandelion root that dried this year, that rescued from the garden and dried that out. So this could be used in an infusing ball again, or the root used in both in teas. Columbo, pennyroyal, sarsaparilla, cassie, mandrake, sumac berries, wahoo, Peruvian bark, cinchona bark, poplar, angelica, bone set, sweet balm, wintergreen, cleavers. Cleavers is one that actually very important and very helpful. This is a plant that I found growing outside just now. It's wintertime. It's also known as bed straw. It's sticky bed straw. In the summertime, it has just these copious burrs on them that are really kind of obnoxious. If you throw it at yourself or at someone, it'll stick right to their clothes. So it's kind of a viney plant, but it's very effective because it actually functions in a refrigerant role. It'll actually has a significant cooling effect on the body. And that's one of its therapeutic properties, is as a refrigerant. So cleavers, masterwort, lily of the valley, which is interesting. Cayenne, so cayenne pepper is beneficial, and gentian root. There's several herbs here that are, we mentioned intermittent fevers earlier on, those that may be low during the day, spike at night when you're trying to rest, and then decrease again. And that's just a very kind of obnoxious oscillation, because just when you're trying to rest, your fever spikes and it makes it difficult to do that. Oftentimes you get body aches with that as well, depending on what kind of a sickness you're dealing with. So intermittent fevers, these are specific for intermittent fevers: apple tree bark, bitter root, buck bean, butternut bark, calamus, and cedron, C-E-D-R-O-N. The sixth approach is using a liquid diet. So a liquid diet can be helpful, especially if it's GI based, and it also can help get you some calories as well as nourishment when you're not feeling like eating a whole lot of anything. A few days on a fluid diet can give the gastrointestinal tract a much needed rest. Drink plenty of water. So water is the greatest solvent known, and it dilutes and carries away toxins that may be accumulated in your digestive tract. The kidneys work well. You want to make sure that you keep them well lubricated and moving. So one of the juices that you can use, orange juice, fresh squeezed orange juice, unsweetened, is very beneficial. So a recommendation was to use 2 quarts of OJ and 2 quarts of oatmeal water separately, alternating through the day. So that's about a gallon of fluid that you would divide over the course of a day, not mixing them together, but just using them individually over the course of a day. And separate the OJ and the oatmeal water by an hour of consumption. So oatmeal water basically is just if you boil oatmeal and drain off the water before it congeals, or have more water than there is to make into an oatmeal, you would have the leftover fluid that we use as oatmeal water. So fruit juices, and again, unsweetened. If you need the sweetness, use raw honey. Sugar is going to increase the acidification of the blood and increase fever. So that's kind of a negative direction. We know that water is powerful. And the next thing I'm going to look at here is hydrotherapy as far as fever reduction. And the place where I gleaned a lot of information about this is from a DVD and book called The Lost Art of Hydrotherapy. It's by Lisa Meisner from sustainablepreparedness.com. It's a very good handbook and tutorial for for hydrotherapy, and a number of different hydrotherapy treatments that cover a wide range of uses. Another thing you can use is from Amazing Discoveries, Practical Home Remedies by Lana Drebit. So that's another DVD that you could watch and get some additional information on hydrotherapy. But the wet sheet wrap is a great way to help reduce fevers. And the wet sheet wrap can be used in four different stages. The first stage is primary fever reduction. And that's basically taking a damp sheet, wrapping yourself in the damp sheet, wrapping yourself in a couple blankets, having some cool water nearby. So initially, you're going to be working with evaporative cooling right away. So it's going to, the first 5 to 15 minutes or so, you're going to have a cooling effect taking place. And if you want to keep that cooling effect going, remove some blankets, kind of fan yourself, sprinkle yourself with a fresh additional water to keep the cooling aspect going. You can monitor your temperature real time with a thermometer to kind of aid your gauging of that fever reduction. So stage two, if you kept yourself wrapped in that blanket and didn't keep the evaporative cooling going, you would move into what's called a neutral wet sheet. And that essentially your sheet warms the body temperature, your muscles relax, you come into a kind of a sleepy, calm state, nerves calm down, and it can basically help reduce congestion and aid sleep. So someone who's maybe has insomnia, they could help bring sleeping to have someone go to sleep easier. If you want to maintain that, go ahead and remove some blankets. But if you want to continue to move to stage three, it's usually after about an hour, this, if you keep that those blankets around, it becomes a heating pack. So your body's going to warm up again and induces sweating and draws blood from congested organs in the body and can aid the elimination of the fever's cause by copious sweating. So again, you want to monitor the temperature, keep the head cool during this period. And at stage four, if you kept wrapped up, you would move into a sweating wet pack. And that's 1 to 2 hours post start of this process. So rapid toxic elimination and immune stimulation occurs at this point. So the wet sheet wrap, you can keep it maintained at fever reduction, move up to a warming sleeping pack, and or just by maintaining the cover and the thermal retention effects, move all the way up into creating a fever spike, which you could do intentionally. If you felt like you might be getting sick, you could do a fever spike intentionally, like a fever treatment, essentially, a controlled approach to an illness you felt coming on. So that's hydrotherapy using the wet sheet wrap. Another way is the chest heating compress. Take a damp cotton t-shirt, put it on, put a trash bag with holes in the sides for your head and arms, put on a wool sweater, cover up and go to sleep for a while. And basically that is very good for mild fevers, congestion, pneumonia, asthma, chest tightness, and cough. So basically focuses on your respiratory organs and your core. And is called the chest heating compress. Again, that's described in the Lost Art of Natural Remedies, hydrotherapy. So we've already mentioned the refrigerants, nature of cleaver or bed straw. That's a very important tool in your tool bag is cleaver. And the whole plant can be used. It's very excellent in all cases of fever, scarlet fever, measles, and all acute diseases. You can use it freely. There's no toxicity to it. But having said that, you don't want to use it for more than 2 weeks in a stretch because there are some tannins in it that you want to give your body a break after 2 weeks of usage. You can give it a 1 or 2 week break before using it again. But using a refrigerant, unless you had like some kind of obnoxious long-term kind of fever-inducing agent, you probably wouldn't need to use it that long anyway. So 1 ounce of cleaver in 1 pint of water, simmer it for 20 minutes, and then take 1 teaspoon 3 times a day for up to 2 weeks at a time. So it cleanses the blood and strengthens the liver as well. There are some essential oils that have been found to be beneficial for fever reduction as well. Peppermint, you can apply these on the head and chest and feet. So peppermint, you want to make sure you dilute peppermint with a carrier oil, because some oils are considered hot. They can cause skin irritation if you don't dilute them with a carrier oil like fractionated coconut oil or almond oil. Frankincense. Frankincense can also be applied. This is frankincense oil, and frankincense can be used neat. That is straight, directly applied to the skin. But with anything that you've never tried before, a small area of trial is a good idea in case you do happen to react to it. Just a good plan of action. Eucalyptus, also very good. Want to make sure that you dilute eucalyptus as well. It can be hot, a hot oil. So lime, cardamom, and lemongrass are also excellent for fever reduction using on a rub. The lime, cardamom, and lemongrass can also be used internally, a few drops in some water and taken. The lemongrass, if you add black pepper to it, can be beneficial. But when you use it internally, you want to make sure that you use a pure therapeutic grade of essential oil that doesn't have any other excipient ingredients as a part of it. So when your fever ends, you want to take it easy. You don't want to add any heavy foods or anything like that. Light, nourishing, easily digestible food. So some examples of that would be like soybean milk, potassium broth, zweibach, basically toast that's been toasted again, baked Irish potato, very ripe banana that's been pureed, whole wheat flakes dissolved in warm soybean milk, just some kind of light, easily digestible foodstuffs. Things to avoid that'll tax your system and maybe what actually started the whole process in the first place in some cases. So avoid all meats, meat broths, fish, fowl, oysters, pickles, all condiments, cheese, dairy, mushrooms, and eggs. Essentially, you're getting way more protein than your body can handle in the recovery stage. And it can cause kind of a relapse or a rebound back into potential illness. So the excess protein can putrefy and draw energy and nutrients to break down, whereas things that are more carb-based or electrolyte-based would be easier to digest for your body. So a fact is that continual use of these protein sources always brings on fever and disease at some point. So to wrap up here, I have a couple quotes here from Ministry of Healing that I'd like to share with you. Ministry of Healing, page 234 and 235, says this: disease never comes without a cause. The way is prepared and disease invited by disregard of the laws of health. Sometimes we do that unintentionally. Many suffer in consequence of the transgression of their parents. While they are not responsible for what their parents have done, it is nevertheless their duty to ascertain what are and what are not violations of the laws of health. They should avoid the wrong habits of their parents and, by correct living, place themselves in better conditions. The greater number, however, suffer because of their own wrong course of action. They disregard the principles of health by their habits of eating, drinking, dressing, and working. Their transgression of nature's laws produce a sure result, and when sickness comes upon them, many do not credit their sufferings to the true cause, but murmur against God because of their afflictions. But God is not responsible for the suffering that follows disregard of natural law. God has endowed us with a certain amount of vital force. He has also formed us with organs suited to maintain the various functions of life, and he designs that these organs shall work together in harmony. If we carefully preserve the life force and keep the delicate mechanisms of the body in order, the result is health. But if the vital force is too rapidly exhausted, the nervous system borrows power for present use from its resources of strength. And when one organ is injured, all are affected. Nature bears much abuse without apparent resistance. She then arouses and makes a determined effort to remove the effects of the ill treatment she has suffered. Her effort to correct these conditions often manifests in fever and various other forms of sickness. And then from Ministry of Healing, page 234 and 235, rational remedies. When the abuse of health is carried so far that sickness results, the sufferer can often do for himself what no one else can do for him. The first thing to be done is to ascertain the true character of the sickness and then go to work intelligently to remove the cause. If the harmonious working of this system has become unbalanced by overwork, overeating, or other irregularities, do not endeavor to adjust the difficulties by adding a burden of poisonous medicines. Intemperate eating is often the cause of sickness, and what nature needs most is to be relieved of the undue burden that has been placed upon her. In many cases of sickness, the very best remedy is for the patient to fast for a meal or two, that the overworked organs of digestion may have an opportunity to rest. A fruit diet for a few days has often brought great relief to brain workers. Many times, a short period of entire abstinence from food, followed by simple, moderate eating, has led to recovery through nature's own recuperative effort. An abstemious diet for a month or two would convince many sufferers that the path of self-denial is the path to health. And then finally, Ministry of Healing, page 315. The effects of a flesh diet may not be immediately realized, but this is no evidence that it is not harmful. Few can be made to believe that it is the meat they have eaten which has poisoned their blood and caused their suffering. Many die of disease wholly due to meat eating, while the real cause is not suspected by themselves or by others. The moral evils of a flesh diet are not less marked than are the physical ills. Flesh food is injurious to health, and whatever affects the body has a corresponding effect on the mind and the soul. Think of the cruelty to animals that meat eating involves, and its effect on those who inflict and those who behold it, how it destroys the tenderness with which we should regard these creatures of God.